Hello guys, welcome back to Techdose, and in this video we will see the intuition of the big O notation used to find the worst case time complexity. So let us get started. What is the worst case time? It is the tightest upper bound of the actual runtime curve which your program gets. So let us assume that you were running a program and the time taken by your program is this red line. And this x-axis denotes time and this y-axis is denoting n, which is the input size. So as the input size increases, the time taken by your program also increases and it follows this curve t. Now what will be the worst case time of your curve t? That is, what is the worst case time of your program? It is the tightest upper bound of this curve t. Now what are the upper bounds? Actually, if you have a curve and let's say it's t, then the upper bound is such a curve which encloses this curve t, which is always greater than this curve t till infinity. Not for the lower values, but till infinity. So let us assume that this is curve A and this is enclosing this t. Then curve A and t should not meet till infinity. And this is curve B, and curve B is also enclosing this curve t. Therefore, you can say that B is also an upper bound of T. But what is the tightest upper bound? Tightest upper bound means that it is the upper bound of this curve T as well as it is closest to this T. So in this curve, you can see that T1 and T2 are the upper bounds of this curve T. But this T1 is more closer to T than this T2. Therefore, you can say that the worst case time for T will be equals to T1. This will be big O of T1. You can also say that it is big O of T2, but this is not correct because there is another curve T1 which is much closer to this curve T as compared to this T2. Therefore, the worst case time of your program will be big O of T1. Now, the worst case time always guarantees that your curve, this time curve, will never exceed this T1. This curve can never exceed this T1. Such that if you extrapolate this curve, then this T will go over this T1. This won't happen at all. Now let us see some examples in order to understand this better. Let us look at the left hand side graph. If your program is taking this time T curve, this red line is the curve made by your program. And this x-axis is time and this y-axis is the number of inputs or the input size. Then what will be the time complexity in this case, the worst case time? In this case, you can see that the upper bounds of this curve T is order of n and order of n square. But you can easily make out that order of n is much closer to this T as compared to order of n square. Therefore, you can say that the tightest upper bound according to this graph will be On. Therefore, the worst case time complexity of your program will be On. Now, what will be the worst case time complexity in this second graph? In this second graph, you can see that the pink curve is the time taken by your program. This is T and this is input size N. The time taken by your program is given by this pink curve. Now, you can easily make out that the upper bounds are T2 and T1. The upper bounds are calculated by taking the larger values of n and not for the smaller values. Since if you can see here, for this smaller value of n value lower than this n naught, this T2 will not be an upper bound. Okay, so we are talking about larger values of n, and so we can see that T2 and T1 are upper bounds of this curve T, but you can say that T2 is much closer to T as compared to T1. Therefore, according to this graph, the worst case time complexity of this time curve T will be equals to big O of T2. So this will be the worst case time in this case. So let us look at the formal definition of this worst case time complexity. For the formal definition, we assume that as time increases, the input size will also increase, or you can say vice versa. This is because the computation will be quite expensive if the input size increases. This is very logical. Now, in this case, how can we define the worst case time? Let us assume that our program is taking this red line f of n curve. This is the time curve of our program. Now, there is another curve which is c into g of n, where c is a constant. And in this case, you can see that for smaller values of n lower than n naught, this f of n is greater than c into g of n. But for values greater than n naught, this c into g of n will always be greater than f of n, and they will never meet till infinity. Okay, so this is the condition. Now c into g of n will be the tightest upper bound of function f of n if and only if f of n is less than equals to c into g of n, because for higher values of n you need this to be true at all times. Now what are the constraints? You can see that the first constraint is that for all values of n greater than n naught, and n naught is a finitely smaller value, and therefore we are talking about the larger values of n. So for the larger values of n, this c into g of n should always enclose this f of n. Now other two constraints are that c and n naught are positive integers and they are always greater than 0. In such a constraint, in such a case, if this is followed, then what will be the worst case time complexity of f of n? You can say that the worst case time for function f of n, which is the actual runtime of your program, will be c into g of n. If all these conditions are true, then the worst case time of f of n will be c into g of n, since this is the tightest upper bound. Now let us look at an example in order to understand these concepts better. Let us assume that we are given a function f of n equals to 3n plus 2. Now what will be the worst case time for this f of n? If you already know how to find the worst case time, then it will be very easy for you to make it out. But how about using this equation which we had formed during the formal definition and using it here in order to prove the worst case time? So our definition was f of n should be less than equals to c into g of n for larger values of n. So I'll put one by one all these options into this g of n, and then we will see which one is fitting better. So instead of f of n, I will write 3n plus 2. And instead of c into g of n, I will write c into the first option. First option is n cube. Now you can easily make out that for larger values of n, this will always be true, because n cube will rise very sharply. This is n cube and this will be around n. So this is rising very sharply, therefore n cube will always enclose this 3n plus 2. Therefore n cube is an upper bound. This is an upper bound of this curve 3n plus 2. Now we will look for the second option. F of n is less than equals to c into g of n. So in this case as well, we will write 3n plus 2 will be less than equals to c into n square. Now if you use your intuition, then you can easily say that this n square is greater than 3n plus 2 for larger values of n. And therefore, whatever may be the value of c, whatever positive integer it may be, it will always be greater than the left hand side. Therefore, this is also an upper bound of this function f of n, which is 3n plus 2. So this will lie between this n and n cube. This is n square. Okay, because n square is lower than n cube. And n square is also enclosing this n. Therefore, n square is closer to n as compared to n cube. So it is more tight. That is, it is tighter than n cube. Now we will look at the third option, which is n. So our option was 3n plus 2. And this should be less than equals to c into n. If you look at it closely, then we can put, instead of c, we can put 4, and this will be 4n. So now this option n is also enclosing this function f of n. Now this function n is actually the same line, but this 3n plus 2 will be slightly higher than this. But when we multiply it by 4, then this n will rise over this 3n plus 2. So if we have this line as 3n plus 2, and this line as n, then if we multiply it by 4 times, then it will rise over this 3n plus 2. It will be 4n. Therefore, you can see that this 4n is lower than n square. This will be your n square line. This will be your n cube line. So this 4n is actually the tightest one among these options. And so this is also an upper bound. And so this is the best option among the first three options. Now, what about the fourth option? Log n. Actually log n is much lower than n. So if you write here 3n plus 2 less than equals to log n c into log n, then for higher values of n, log n will not increase as sharply as n increases. Because if this is the line for n, then the line for log n will look like this. It will flatten out. And therefore, they are divergent lines. Okay. Since they are divergent and log n is lying below n, therefore this gap will keep widening. So this can never enclose, log n can never enclose this n. Therefore, our best option will be option 3. And as you know, this 3n plus 2 will be order of n. So this will be the correct option. One important point to note is that if you are given a curve t, which is the actual runtime of your program, and you are finding the tightest upper bound, then you should always see that the tightest upper bound should be either parallel or a divergent line. Because if you take a convergent line, this one is a divergent line since the gap is widening. And in the parallel line, the gap will remain the same. So if this is t and this is a parallel line, then this gap will always remain the same. But for divergent lines, this gap will keep increasing. So if you have a parallel curve or a divergent curve, then only you can consider this curve above this t as your worst case time complexity. But if it is a convergent curve, what about a convergent curve? If this is t and this is a convergent curve, then after some point of time, if you extrapolate, then this curve will cross and it will come below t. So for larger values of n, this t will overtake this curve, let's say it's a. Therefore, this a can never be an upper bound of this curve t. So for convergent curves, you cannot say that this will be the worst case time of t. No, it's only true if the curves are parallel or divergent. So this you should always keep in mind. I hope you are able to understand the intuition of big O notation. Next we will see the intuition of big omega notation. Till then, stay tuned to our channel, subscribe to our channel, and see you in our next video. Thank you.